So, good morning from me as well. I will be talking about light signal detection and also a bit about the history or previous solutions starting in 2012, when actually I wasn't doing it. But first of all, the structure of the talk is as follows. First of all, I give a short problem statement. What problem do we need to solve? Then I'll start with what we did in 2012 shortly, then a different idea in 2013, and then I'll present the current solution, which will be the majority of the talk. So the problem in 2012, it actually, this is one example of the way it looked. This is the delivery zone from the old playing field. This is a particularly funny situation because as opposed to the rest of the playing field, we had to use completely different algorithms for this special case. Green background behind the signal lights, so there's no use in looking for any green color because there's this green all over the picture. So yeah, that was a very interesting special case of the problem. Today I think it's actually gotten simpler, although you do have to cope with more background noise because the signals are higher up, so you have like more people in the picture, but still you would have to have a pretty big person with a pretty big green t-shirt to get a problem like the delivery zone. And yeah, so let's look at the actual situation we need to deal with. Currently, this is what it looks. This is the this is an unstructured pile of pixels, and from this, first of all, we need to determine which part of the picture we consider the red signal, the yellow, and the green signal. Then we want to know which of these is on or off. And along with that, we also need some sort of confidence estimate because the detection is never going to be perfect, and we need some estimate of how reliable the output is going to be. And this is what we call the visibility history of a detection. We simply use the number of consecutively successfully detected frames. So if you would be had successfully detected a signal for 1 second, that would mean a visibility history of 30 frames. But it gets more complicated because these signals can also be blinking. So you have a whole new issue. You have to observe the signal over time and have to remember what you've seen in a certain number of previous frames to know whether it's blinking or not. The first solution we had in 2012 was very rudimentary. Actually, we couldn't play the game that well at all. So in fact, we only needed to detect whether the signal is red or not. We didn't even care about blinking or anything. And for that, we used a simple lookup table where you basically list all the colors you consider as part of a certain color, in this case, red. The problem with this approach was how do you train it? You can't just list those colors by hand. It's many, many colors. So what we did was to use a rather complex software. This is I couldn't even use the software right now, so this is a mock-up I made with GIMP, but the principle is this. You use a fuzzy select tool and try to select all the colors that match your idea of green. Then you would export this into a static file, try to move this file somehow on the robot and run your signal detection plugin with it. Yeah, the solution was obviously very, very simple. It had no blink detection at all. Training was pretty involved. not only because you had to train, had to work with this external piece of software, but also because it was rather detached from the actual plugin doing the signal detection. It was also unmaintained and unstable. It was a pretty complex piece of software which used to crash, and in the end we ditched it and came to a different solution. In 2013, this is what we did. The idea was that if you put the robot in front of a signal light and it's equipped with a laser scanner, then the signal, this cylindrical signal light, creates, of course, laser reflections all in the same spot, approximately. And you can use the point cloud library to make a clustering, run a clustering algorithm on this on the laser scan data. And you can also compute the centroid of this cluster. And this would give a pretty accurate estimate of the position of this signal light. Exactly there. Of course, this is not all. This is not the whole problem, because if you get this centroid of the laser cluster, you also have to know the extrinsic parameters of the camera to transform this 3D coordinate in relative to the laser scanner into a 3D coordinate relative to the camera. And with the intrinsic parameters and what you know about the measurements of the signal glasses, you can determine relatively exactly where you want to look for the red part of the signal, for the yellow part, and for the green part, so that you don't have to even know about colors anymore. Colors don't matter if you know exactly where to look, you only have to look for brightness, and you can determine the signal, theoretically. There were some problems with this. Among others, of course, the mechanics connecting the laser scanner to the camera is the robot, which is pretty complex and it's not perfectly stable. It's noisy. It gets unsettled. You need to calibrate the whole thing. This solution turned out not to be entirely perfect, although it was algorithmically pretty simple. The tuning was also, you mainly had one tuning problem, which was calibrating the geometry of the laser scanner versus the camera. And this would get disturbed by mechanics noise, obviously. But I think the bigger problem we had with this was that sometimes the clustering algorithm converged to a point just a little bit beside the signal. And we couldn't really find a way to control that. We had to live with it. And sometimes we would end up looking just slightly beside the signal, which would create false positives, of course, because you have other bright light sources somewhere. You would have like spots from outside the playing field, or people with bright t-shirts, or whatever. In the end, we decided this was not reliable enough. And in fact, we were wasting all of the color information. In 2014, we came up with this solution. The funny thing is that the UV color space, which gets produced natively by most cameras, as opposed to the RGB color space, the UV color space is pretty useful, actually, because first of all, you don't need to do any conversions. You can just pull it out of the camera and use it. and it looks like this. It's of course a 3D space. The dimensions are named y, u, and v, and the y dimension only describes the luminance of the picture, or you can imagine this as the brightness. And you have two other dimensions that describe the color, or the chrominance. And yeah, this is what it looks like with a luminance value of zero. This is what it looks like with higher brightness values. The colors stay similar over the changing luminance value. So what you can do with this is you simply remember a point somewhere in 3D space. Of course, you have to imagine this as a 3D point because it's on a plane in 3D space. And you remember a buffer around it. This buffer is, of course, cylindrical. And then you have a pretty efficient algorithm to determine whether a certain color is within this cylindrical buffer. This is the algorithm in pseudocode. Along with the reference color you want to detect, you also have to have a threshold on the saturation. Because if you have low saturation, the difference between the colors is too little. So what you do is basically you have two-dimensional color chroma vectors, and you just subtract them, normalize them with the saturation values, and then you check the length of the difference vector. And the length of the difference vector between those two color vectors is just, well, the color difference between those two colors. And of course, you also have to check the saturation threshold. And that's it. The whole thing is 10 lines of code in C++. It was ported from the VLC player. So yeah, that's a pretty simple solution. Of course, that's not the whole problem, because this only tells you whether one certain pixel matches a certain color. If you want to detect regions in a picture with this, you have to do a little more, which is to use a classifier. You can imagine this as the output of the color model. So this may not be the actual pixels, but only whether the color model tells us, well, this pixel is red and this other pixel is not. So we only see red pixels here. And one important parameter of the classifier is the neighborhood matches, the number of matches in the neighborhood of a certain pixel. For this, let's look at, for example, at this pixel. To determine the neighborhood, you look two pixels in each direction and just count which other matching pixels are there. There are, of course, none, so this pixel is ignored. Next one, this has a neighborhood of 7 matching pixels, so this is also ignored. This one has 9 matches in its neighborhood, so we use it. Next one has 11 matches as well, so we use this. Same thing for the other pixels. By the way, of course, we go through the picture row by row. This one again has 2 little matches, the next ones they match, and so on. In the end, we end up using these pixels and draw a rectangular region around it. This region has overall 16 pixels inside of it. And of course, the classifier algorithm can do some additional filtering on the ROIs it gets. For example, of course, you can specify a minimum value on the number of pixels you want to have inside. Those that do not match it would get thrown out. It can grow or shrink existing regions, or they can be merged if they are adjacent to each other. But yeah, that's pretty straightforward and rather simple. In the end, it looks like this. if you visualize it. When I got this, I thought I'd solved the problem. Because the color model works, and I get pretty decent, if I tune the color model right, I got pretty decent regions of interest around the red and green parts of the signal. And then I only had to do a brightness classification to determine which signal was on. But as you can tell, obviously there are other colored parts inside the picture. So how do we deal with this? For example, how do we know that these two pieces here are actually part of the signal, but this one is not? The first criterion is pretty obvious. The red and green regions of interest have to be vertically aligned. Their left and right borders have to have the approximately the same y coordinate. The same, yeah, it's the same y coordinate. and also the distance between those two needs to be pretty much the same as the height. And if this is the case, we can put a yellow region of interest between those two, and then we know that this is a signal. So as for the code complexity, the actual color model is just 10 lines of code. That's very simple. The initial implementation that does pretty much everything up until this point was 300 lines of code, excluding the classifier, which is a library. But the current implementation has more than 2,200 lines of code, which is actually pretty crazy. Over the course of doing this, I came to the conclusion that there's a tendency towards something what I would call the 80-20 rule. It has been observed in other domains as well. Do 20% of the work, which solve 80% of the problem, but if you want to solve the rest of the problem, you have to do most of the work. What happened there? What's the rest of the problem? Because it looks pretty straightforward up to this point. If you look at this picture, you can see, for example, that there is a little green reflection on this aluminum profile behind the signal. And of course, what can happen is that the classifier determines this to be part of the green signal. So suddenly we run into some border case which we cannot assemble to a signal anymore using the given heuristics. So what to do about this? The first intuition might be to just tune it out of the color model or tune it out of the classifier. But as you can see here, this is not so simple, because this is what actually happens. The state jitters, the result you get jitters between those two states. And you cannot get enough consecutive detections because you need to observe the signal for a certain amount of time. Now you see me walking behind it, trying to disturb it somehow. It doesn't really change much. We still have this jitter. But now in a few seconds, something happens and suddenly the situation is stable. What has changed? In this video, you could probably see it. There was a change in the brightness. That's because I put a cut at this particular moment. This is what it looks like. There was a slight change in brightness. Maybe a cloud moved out of the sun or something. I don't know. Maybe the light just got brighter. So the real problem is not actually jitter. If you have like simple jitter, you can tune your system to go one way or the other. But if you have jitter between a stable detection and an unstable detection, or like jitter between jitter and non-jitter, that's a real problem, because you can't, that's what do you do about it? You can't just tune it out, because in this situation, I wouldn't even have known which parameter has changed here. So what we ended up doing was simply to revive this approach, only this time without discarding the color information. And of course, the laser detection also looks a little different now. Now we're standing in front of one of these MPS tables. And in this situation, we do a line detection algorithm on the laser data, which gives us the endpoints of this line that's formed in the laser data by the facing front of the MPS table. And of course, if we assume that the signals are mounted approximately in the same position, we can compute from the edge of the table where we would expect the signal light. And yeah, well, that's in theory a big help. Let's look at that later. Right now, let's look at the complete pipeline we have with this whole system. As inputs, we get the raw image, of course, and some region of interest that's computed from this laser line, transforming it into the camera frame and then computing a pixel from it. This we use to classify the picture. And with the region of interest we get out of the classifier, we try to assemble a signal with lots of complex heuristics, some of which I explained before. And this then has to be mapped onto all of the observations we've seen before. So we need to check which of the previous signals we've seen are matched with the signal we've just assembled in the current frame. Then we can do the brightness classification to determine which of these signals are on or off. And of course, we also have to remember the history of which signal, when, at which time, which signal was on or off, to do the blinking detection. This actually uses the Shen-Weaver principle. We just observe n plus one frames, where n is just the number of frames we need to observe for one on-off cycle. And this goes into the output. Of course, we have to select the signals somehow. We might get signals which are actually which we've just discovered, or which might be bad for some reason. And of course, we have to weed out the bad ones, so we output only the best ones we can see. And this is a pretty important feature. Most of the, or a lot of the data from this pipeline are rendered into a tuning image, which is also, of course, updated live. This, by the way, looks like this. The pink region you see moving is the one that's computed from the laser data. And here you can see a pretty stable detection of red and green. And of course, now I can disturb it all I want. It doesn't have any problem with this. As you can tell from the white region of interest around the green signal, that the algorithm is giving a stable output in this situation. Even now that I turned on the red light, the red region of interest basically breaks down. There's not even any red anymore. There's only some tiny spots in the top and in the bottom. And in fact, the yellow signal produces more red output than the red signal. But still, the algorithm converges to a very stable estimate, even of the yellow signal, because there's a lot of heuristics involved in dealing with the situation. There's special cases for all kinds of situations that can happen, just like what you've just seen. So, yeah, no disturbance from this. So to sum this up, there is considerable complexity from, I don't know, just technical stuff like setting everything up, dealing with buffers and shoving around data. But the biggest issue is really those special cases for when somehow the color detection breaks down or doesn't produce perfect outputs. In fact, there's 16 different ways of trying to match a red and a green light. So, in fact, you have to iterate over all the red and green regions of interest you found in the picture and assemble them combinatorially to try and find out which ones are part of a common signal. And there's in each iteration you have to try 16 different cases, and in the end we have like more than 21 different ways of assembling a signal. The result from this is that we get almost no false positives, which was particularly important because false positives tend to mess up your world model. Not only will you make a wrong decision in the current situation, but you will also probably continue on making bad decisions because what you believe about the world will be wrong. Another pretty important feature, I considered this a gimmick at first when I implemented it. I thought, well, this is nice. You get a notification when the config file changes. So let's use that and try to allow changing the config at runtime. But this turned out to be a very important feature because I didn't expect how much tuning would be involved. At each competition, I end up doing hours of calibration, recalibration, and also some playing around with the code. So this live tuning is really, really helpful. And of course, in certain cases, you also have a very high CPU load, especially if you don't have any laser data. If you don't get data from the laser, let's say the line detection algorithm doesn't converge, then you have to look in the whole picture and throw all of your heuristics at the full picture. And that, of course, ends up with a very high CPU load. The code is rather complex. And of course, it's optimized for readability, so that also doesn't help performance. And we're back with this old problem of mechanical noise, especially during a game. If we have some collisions or somebody bumps into the robot, it gets unset very easily. So what would I do if I had to do it all over again? When I started with it, I thought, wow, this simple color classification algorithm is perfect. But obviously it's not. A much better solution that's also pretty straightforward would be to use histograms. With histograms, you could do much more reliable detection of what you consider a signal light, because of course you get like some green elements but those green elements somewhere else in the picture will not have the same histogram as a green signal light, because that's rather characteristic. But I think no matter what you do, in some form, you will always run into this 80-20 principle. Maybe the sum of the work you have to do will be less, but once you got your basic algorithm running, I think that's when the real work begins. And of course, if you know about this beforehand, you can also maybe make better design decisions. You might not know which problems you will run into when you use different algorithms, but what I would have done would be to not hard code these search heuristics, all these geometric heuristics that handle all kinds of special cases. Of course, you can put those into a configurable pipeline, for example, to make it more flexible and also more transparent. Right now, if you use the system, you might get surprised sometimes by what the heuristics do, because it's not in the config file. Overall, this whole problem is worth tackling, absolutely, at least with the current rule set, because it has a high points to efforts ratio, despite of the potential complexity. In fact, in recent years, I was the only person doing it. And that's why you probably really want to do it, and you really want to try and do it well, because it will get you points. During the last RoboCup, we scored almost all of our points during the exploration phase. And in fact, we got into real trouble in the finals, because we were a little unlucky and the Swiss team had a working exploration phase and they were a little bit lucky, and we actually trembled there for a few minutes when they really caught up to us, simply because we didn't have a production that would score lots of points. And the Swiss team, they got their exploration phase. Well, probably it was more rudimentary than ours, but as it happens, they were lucky and really almost caught up to us. If you do it, of course, obviously you will want to write readable code, especially if you start hacking away at special cases. And the toolset you put around this whole thing is also very important. I didn't realize this when I started, but now I'd really emphasize this. It's not only for the person dealing with this as their main job, but also if you want to pass it on to another person. You might not want to require everyone to understand the whole system fully. Maybe you can just, if you have simple tools, you can just let a person understand these tools and use the system. Now, with the hands-on session, I would like you to get accommodated with the tools that are involved. It's not that many, actually. You just need some tool to look at the debug buffers, at the output images. You will also need some color picker program. I don't know what you have for this, but you will have to pick colors off your screen to tune the algorithm. I have some programs I use for this. We'll have to see what Fedora has to offer on this, and of course you need SSH to edit the config, and that's pretty much it. And with that, well, you just take a look at the robots, check out all those tools, and play around with it a little bit. and see what happens, see what's involved in the and calibrating the mechanics and the color model. Yeah, that's it. So.